Okay, so I think we start as foreseen at a quarter to two, the afternoon session. The first speaker is Emmanuel Perez, with contribution also from Christoph Leonidopoulos, Progress on Online Studies.
Can you hear me? Yeah, now it's on. Thank you. Right, so our report on online aspects that are relevant for FCC, so triggers and all that. So we may have in mind that at high energy plus and minus colliders, triggering is not really an issue. However, at the FCC, at the Z-peak in this crabway scheme, where you expect a tremendously high luminosity and where you have many, many bunches which are only 10 nanoseconds apart. Also, the detector will probably have many channels. If you use the IRC detectors as an example, this is typically a factor of 10 larger for the number of readout channels compared to what you have in the current LHC detectors. So because of all that, the Z-peak running, especially in the high luminosity option, may actually pose some online issues that had not been encountered earlier in a high energy plus and minus collision. So in all the rest of this presentation, when I will talk about the FCC, I will mean FCC at the Z-peak and in the crab waste scheme. So this slide is to quantify things a bit. So the plot on the right shows the cross sections of various physical processes as a function of the energy in the center of mass. So the leading one is the plus and minus goes to QQ bar. And at the Z-peak, this value of the cross-section leads, when you have a luminosity of 2 times 10 to 36, to a rate of something like 65 kilohertz. So adding in the leptonic fire state and making that a round number, that's roughly something like 100 kilohertz. And basically, you do want to keep all these events on tape because you need all these statistics in order to reach the precision that you are aiming at. So that means that you need to write 2 disks, 100 kilohertz of physics event. So 100 kilohertz, that's quite high for a trigger rate if you compare with the trigger rates that the LHC experiments are typically writing. For example, for the high luminosity LHC, Atlas and CMS plan to write to disk only 5 kilohertz of event. So that's quite high. However, of course, what really matters is not just the trigger rate, but it is the data volume that you are writing to disk, so the throughput to the disk. So you have to multiply the trigger rate by the size of your event in bytes. So in order to determine at FCC what would be the throughput to disk, you would need to know what is the typical event size at the FCC. So for that, I've looked up a bit in the literature and I found a statement in the Tesla TDR saying that the multijet event in the Tesla detector would be about 200 kilobytes. So that would be fine because if you take the 100 kilohertz I was mentioning before times 25 times 200 kilobytes, that would be a data throughput of 20 gigabytes per second. That's what at high luminosity LHC, Atlas and CMS are planning to do. So this would be okay. But in the Tesla TDR, you also read that when you take into account the background, this increases the size from 200 kilobytes to 5 megabytes. And this, of course, would be quite a different story. So, according to it. So what is indeed making all this background at the IRC, which is making most of the data volume? So most of it is actually coming from pair production, which is largely induced by beam straddling photons. So what happens if you have all these beam straddling photons that are created, they make gamma-gamma interactions, they create E plus E minus pairs. So these are mostly low PT particles, so most of them are swept away by the magnetic field, but some do enter into the detector, especially the vertex detector, and because the field because of the field, they will enter many times in the vertex detector and make many hits. So this is what is causing the high occupancies in the vertex detector. Another thing that happens is that you have these beam straddling photons, or possibly these created pairs, that can make showers in material that you have in the forward region, like the Lumi calorimeter, for example, which can lead to secondaries that can backscatter into the main detector. And this is what is causing the background in the central detector, in the central tracker, and in the calorimeter. So based on that, there are two questions that appear as relevant. What would be the pair production background at the FCC? We know that we expect a much lower Beamstrahlung than at IRC still. Will it be a negligible effect on the data volume? And second question is, what is the event size of a physics event in a FCC detector? So we have started to address these two questions since the last workshop. So pair production background at the FCC. So in order to evaluate this background, there is a standard tool that was written by Daniel Schulte. This is a guinea pig, Monte Carlo. So it takes into account all the E plus E minus production processes. So I won't go into the details of this table, but if you just compare what you have at the FCC with what you have at the IRC, you can see that at FCC you will have 15 times less pairs than what is created at IRC 500 GV, and the amount of energy that is carried by all these pairs is more than two orders of magnitude lower. May also note that the dominating processes that are creating these pairs are different. So, bon, guinea pig does not only provide you with these numbers, but it also gives you the kinematics of the plus E minus pairs. So then it's easy to take the kinematics of these particles and track the charged particles through the magnetic field of the main solenoid, and then you can take intersections of the trajectories of the charged particles with cylindrical layers that you put at various radius that would correspond to the layers of an hypothetical vertex detector. Of course, when doing that, you have to take into account the loopers, so the fact that a charged particle will enter many times in your detector. And then you can just count the number of hits in a layer at a given radius, and then divide by the area of the layer, and this gives you this heat occupancy per surface unit per bunch crossing as a function of the layer. So the heat occupancy corresponding to FCC is shown in red. In black, you see the same for the IRC.
Manuel, excuse me, what is the typical energy? What is the critical energy you're tracking?
For these pairs here?
Yeah.
They are very low.
Yeah, it but was, very low means...
But the IRC, it was 1 GV, if I remember. No.
1 GV is a lot. No, no. I mean, I think these were the points that were shown in the TPC as because I think if it's relevant or not, in this simulation you are just tracking any particle, and mostly it will be photon that produce somewhere a pair, and I don't know what is the absorption before, because there is you have layers that of detector. I mean.
I agree. This is a simplified model. This gives an idea of what you would have only for the first layer of the vertex detector, because indeed above, things will be different. Still, I will show later that the result of a full simulation gives some occupancy that are quite close to what you have with this simplified model.
I mean, when I read the R 50 centimeter, 5 centimeter means there is nothing between 0 and 5 centimeter.
Would not put your first layer so far away. Yeah, that's
okay.
Right. Yeah, the
okay.
Point is missing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah,
so what you can see is that you have a factor of 10 lower occupancies in your vertex detector at FCC compared to at IRC. And the other curves that are shown there is FCC at 250 GV compared to the occupancies that you have at the CPC machine that are shown in blue, just for information. Then taking these numbers, all this was done with a field of 4 Tesla. And what is nice with this simplified model is that you can easily play with the parameter, so you can change the field. And this shows what is the effect of having a field of 2 Tesla instead of 4. And you see that you would multiply your occupancies by a factor of typically 2.5 to 3. So back to the case where you have 4 Tesla in your field. So let's assume that you put your innermost layer of your vertex detector very close to the beam pipe at 1.2 centimeter. So you would get 260 hits on average per bunch crossing in this layer. So now taking that, you will need something like 32 bits in order to encode the information of each channel. This would make a data volume of 1 kilobyte. So if you are using some pixels a la LHC, where you have a timestamp resolution that is better than the time separation between two bunch crossing, this would be it. If, on the other hand, you were making use of very finely segmented pixels, like the one that that are planned to be used for the ILC, so for which, with the current technology and with the current readout electronics, it would take several tens of microseconds for each readout chips to read all these pixels. So let's say 20 microseconds, for example. 20 microseconds is only 30 bunch crossings at the ILC, but at FCC, this would be 2,000 crossings. So of course, if you were to integrate the signal over 2,000 crossings, this data volume would be considerably larger. Still, I guess it's reasonable to believe that in 15 years from now, the technology will have evolved sufficiently that it will be ready to read out very fast, finely segmented detectors. So for the rest, I will stick to these. So I think this was it. Yeah, this was it with this simple model. So like I said, this can allow to give a hint of what can be the occupancy in the innermost layer of the detector. If you want to know what are the occupancies in the other parts of the detector, there is no simple model that you can play with, and you have to resort to a full simulation. So what has been done here is to make use of the MUCA package. So MUCA is a GN4 simulation developed by the ILC people, and that is also used by the CLIC team. So I've used the ILD design in this example. So it's a simulation both of the ILD detector and of all the ILD forward regions and the beam delivery system. This plot shows the distributions obtained corresponding to 50 bunch crossings simulated with guinea pig under the FCC conditions. So you see on the top left a distribution showing the number of hits in the vertex detector, not just the first layer, it's everything. So you see, you would expect on average 90 hits in this configuration. That's consistent with the model, taking into account the fact that in this design, the innermost layer is quite at higher radius than what I had before. Then one sees that all these particles that enter in the vertex detector, they don't go further. You do see no entry in the TPC. Still, you do see some occupancy in the HCAL, mostly in the HCAL end cap. You have here on average 350 hits that are expected in the HCAL end cap. So this must be particles that backscatters and come back to the end cap. And you do see a little activity in the HCAL, 5 hits on average, so much lower than the HCAL. I guess that the HCAL is basically shielding the HCAL. So the fact that you have no heat here in the TPC, that's good news, because, once again, for a TPC that would extend in Z up to 2 meters or so, you would need a readout time of 50 microseconds in order to read the signal. And again, 50 microseconds is 100 bunch crossing at the ILC, but this would be 5,000 crossing at the FCC. So you would have to, for whatever mean occupancy that value that you would see in this plot, you would have to multiply by 5,000 to get the relevant number. So in this example, it is zero. Of course, this does depend a lot on how your on the details of your forward region. I remind here that I have used the IRC-like forward region. It's certainly very important to limit the backscattering if you were to use a TPC. In this slide, so the first column is basically a summary of the plots that I have just shown. So you have the mean occupancies in the various detectors for the pair production background, so this 90 hits on average in the vertex detector, and so on. So then, taking for each of these detectors the number of bits that is indicated there in order to encode the information of each channel. So I picked that up in the ILC TDR, basically, after checking that they look reasonable. So this would sum up to not much, to a few kilobytes for a pair background event. I also ran, in addition to this pair background events, I also ran a simulation of some example physics processes. So let's look, for example, at Z to jets. So here, as expected, you see a much larger number of hits in the detectors, and this would sum up to something like 30 kilobytes. So comments on this table is, as said, the pair production background leads to a small data volume. Concerning the TPC occupancy, so we said at the beginning that E plus E minus to QQBAR rate is 65 kilohertz at FCC. That means that you have one QQBAR event every 15 microseconds. So it means that within the readout time of your TPC, you will have a pileup of 3 to 4 Q2 bar events in the TPC. So since according from this table, this would be 1,500 hits for one event. So for three, four events, this would be 5,000 hits in your TPC. So with 50 bits per channel, this would be 30 kilobytes of TPC integrated. So this means that with the TPC, you would have an offset of several tens of kilobytes to add to the raw data. For a given trigger event, you would have to integrate all the data of your read-up time.
I mean, we could be smart and read the TPC in a continuous way, if you want, assign the bit to the events.
Then indeed, it depends what you want to write to tape. If you want to write the raw data, this would be it. Then there may be some way to be smarter and to clean things up before writing the data.
No, I meant something different. If I understood correctly, you are saying that we trigger on one event and we record for that event the information of TPC. When we trigger on the next event, some of that information has already been written in the previous event. Am I right?
That's right, indeed.
So, in principle, you could imagine
there
that
can
you,
be some smart
you can write the TPC continuously and then assign. Now, I never thought of this problem. But it's an interesting problem, why you mentioned.
So, in the most pessimistic case, this would be a few tens of kilobytes per event, so that would mean that one Z to mu mu event would not be 2 kilobytes, but 2 kilobytes plus this offset, similarly for a BABA event. So all this is the Z peak, but the last column, which is ZH, this was just to show how this evolves if you have a very crowded event, so an event with 4 high energy jets.
I guess the columns can be applied to any center of mass. I mean, Z to jet would be always the same.
Well, yeah.
A bit more, I mean, that will not change so much. With
if the jets have more energy, then you will have more
bit more,
of course.
Yeah.
Of course, I mean, E plus and minus 2 hadrons, I mean, when you're at the Z pole, is 3 orders of magnitude compared to the continuum. I mean, so...
Yeah, but this is just even size. It will increase a little bit with energy, but it's a
new event in the final state
will always be then you have a factor of 5 at least. I'm changing topic now. From gamma to hadrons. So because you consider only the pair background, the QED one.
Yeah, I'm coming to that. Yeah. Okay. Well, at least I will have one remark about that next. So I think we've been through this. Next slide. All right. Taking together these numbers, which have been obtained with several caveats and approximations, still, if one says that you have 65 kilohertz of QQ bar events of size, say, 100 kilobytes, this is 6.5 gigabytes per second. You also need to register to record some BABA events to measure the luminosity. So in this exercise, I assume that you have the Yumi calorimeter that goes, as in the ILD design, down to 30 millirad. If you integrate the BABA cross-sections down to this angle, you have a rate of 260 kilohertz. And if you take this 30 kilobytes per event for each BABA, that's then 8 gigabytes per second. So even in this extreme case, where you have a TPC, where you have a low angle UMICAL, and where you write the full raw data without any clever thing, it does sum up to 14 gigabytes per second. It's not challenging. If you remember what I had on the first slide, high luminosity LHC will do 20 gigabytes per second, even more. So even in this case, it does not look dramatic. So still, indeed, there are several sources of background that we need to estimate. This was only the pair production background. We have to look at gamma-gamma to hadrons. This may be something. At the backscattering of Beamstrahlung photons. So for these two processes, one can simulate them with a guinea pig. However, in order to take properly, well, to look at the backscattering of these Beamstrahlung photons, you need, of course, the geometry of the forward region to account properly for the backscattering. And this we'll have to see with the MDI group how we could implement a geometry that would be more realistic for the FCC than the ILC that has been assumed here. Then there may be other sources of background, synchrotron radiation, beam halo, beam gas, possibly background from injection, from beam dumps. So that's again something that we'll have to see with MDI, how we can simulate these. And that's, yeah, that's basically, that is for the event size. Yeah. Then there are other aspects that we try to think about. One is concerns the trigger architecture. So do we want a level one trigger or do you want a software only trigger? As you know, both ILC and LHCB plan to run with a software trigger only, even though this is for different reasons. So if you don't have a level one hardware trigger, this means that all your detectors are sending to the system that is building the event some data at the bunch crossing rate. So again, yeah, for the high luminosity LHC, the data throughput from the front ends to the event builder would be of the order of 2 terabytes per second. At the FCC, assuming only, again, the background from pair production, this would be just a fraction of these. So at least just from this background alone, the data volume to be transferred to the event builder should not be a showstopper for a software-only trigger. Still, we, of course, have to review the pros and cons and understand the constraints that a software-only trigger may put on the detector. Another question that we have to think of concerns the requirements set by physics analysis. So if we want to control the trigger efficiencies down to 10 to the minus 4 or so, this is quite a challenge. So we'll have to think of what is the precision that we can expect from methods like tag and probe, and what are the redundancies that would be needed in order to ensure an in-situ control of these inefficiencies. And yeah, last slide about the organization of the working group. So we have recently set up a wiki which summarizes where we stand in our brainstorming. We have quite good contact with the people who are working on these similar questions for CEPC, and we just start to organize a working group, and hopefully we will be able to call for a working group meeting shortly after these workshops, and obviously we'll have to work in close connection with the software group, the MDI, the detector group, and people doing physics analysis.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Very, very nice. Questions?
Maybe to go back to your estimate of gamma-gamma hadrons, can you go back to your table where you quote the event size for Z, JJ? So I was checking now here my cross-sections, and the ratio of gamma-gamma hadrons to E plus and minus hadrons at the Z-pole is a factor of 5, roughly. So you have 150K of gamma-gamma hadrons, and this increases logarithmically with energy, so okay. So say, I don't know, So you have 150 kilobytes from gamma-gamma hadrons. That's my guess.
Same PT range? Because this will depend a lot on the...
It's true that it's much softer. It's much softer, of course. But
okay.
I mean, the average multiplicity of a Z into the Z pole, the average multiplicity is seven charge hadrons. So this is much. This is...
Because if they are very...
Seven per jet, so...
It will be similar to the gamma-gamma goes to E plus E minus. They will enter the vertex detector, make occupancy there, but should not create too much background in the in the main tracker, in the TPC in particular.
The event size of gamma-gamma events at the Z pole cannot be larger than the Z events.
No, but maybe indeed...
When you are outside the Z pole, all this does matter because it's peanuts compared to the Z pole.
You would have more pile-up. Maybe this is what he meant. You would have more pile-up. Here I took only E plus E minus to QQ bar.
Yeah.
If you multiply this by 5 to account for gamma-gamma, you would have more pile-up in your TPC, for example.
Okay, but I mean, in a case, it would be small compared to the Z. Whatever you do would be small compared to the Z. Other questions?
Why is CPC only a factor of 3 much less.
You mean for these occupancies there? Or?
Yeah. I mean, CPC seems to be very close to FCC at the Z, right? And they're running with very low luminosity.
Yeah, so this is FCC at the Z with a crab waste scheme.
Yeah. And the CPC, they're running, you know, a factor of 100 less luminosity, so they shouldn't be so close.
I cannot answer. I have cross-checked these with the CPC people. So I cannot tell out of my head what can be the reason for this.
One of the possible reasons is the following: that we have our bunch crossings are many, but they are, each have a very doesn't have much luminosity, while the CPC has few bunches, and in the 20 microseconds which surround one bunch, you understand, there's more luminosity in 20 microseconds at CPC than there is in our system, which has many more 20 microsecond slices in which there is events per second. So that may make the difference.
Over there.
Maybe just a comment. I don't see any reason we should use a hardware level one trigger. I think software is always better, and I don't see any reason to go to hardware.
Any comment?
Not really, because I have we have not really thought about it yet. Yeah. Since indeed it seems that it would not put really too harsh constraint on your even building system. Indeed, maybe.
Okay, let's thank Emmanuel again.